to this talk about theater and quantum age. I can show you three people that don't really come from our middle, but someone actually recalled me from with the Seabase study, but they come from the theater in Dortmund, and they know what we can do as a community and what we can achieve. And they want you they want to ask you something. So we are really excited if you can if Kai, Maria and Lucas can tell us something about this. We're happy to be here. Let's introduce ourselves. My name is Kai Voges. I'm the chief of the theater in Dortmund, and I'm Mario Simon. I'm a video artist, media guy at the theater. I'm Lucas Pless, and I'm some kind of the nerd at the theater. This is really special to be here and to be able to speak here, because we think that the CCC and the theater in Dortmund have a lot in common.
Ich möchte ein paar Sätze über das Theater reden.
I want to say something about the theater. Theater is an art form that's really special because it's in the present. So the art only happens in the moment when the people on stage and the audience shares a room. And in Dortmund, we really felt the need to work on this. The special thing on the theater is being in the present. We also have to make present theater. Literature that can be old, like 200, 400 years, and in the books, architecture stays a lot of time, and music can also stay, and it's staying art, but the theater, it disappears. You can actually record it, but the cinema is a lot more interesting to people. The possibility to have theater as a present art form, you can react on actual happenings and rethought. Well, what are the topics of our time? The theater in Dortmund said, we believe that globalization and the migration movements and the digitalization, that these are the main three topics of the present, and we have to take care of that and look at it and look at the world, how it changes with these topics. And we have to find new thoughts, new ideas for handling the digital age, in the globalized age. If we have a theater of the present on these topics, digitalization, globalization, migration, these pieces are not enough to show Romeo and Juliet, and these two guys know them, and they run away and they meet in secrecy, and they're dead. Or if it's a comedy, they marry in the end. These are structures that don't touch the core of the problems of society in digital age. And how can we achieve this to tell stories for the digital age? And we brought you four examples in one search where we try to make current theater. And the first piece I want to show you is The Golden Age. It's 100 ways to kick ass of destiny. And if you open the newspapers, besides the MediaMarkt advertisements and the lotto numbers and sports results, there's also migrants drowning in the Mediterranean Sea, and it's really overwhelming to see it in the media. It's kind of a shock for everyone. We have to play with some parts of this and a few parts of that what breaks out over us in this media world. We have to make sure we are not under shock. I was really amazed by the opportunity to use Ableton Live, the software, where you can make loops and you can create new loops and connect them with each other. And I was wondering how it looks like in the digital technology to use it on live on stage. And so we made samples. It was six people on stage, two musicians, and a whole technology on the theater around it. And we made samples from music, from language recorded live, from gestures, and also on theater texts by, well,
Chekhov
to a call to TV series. And it was from culture of the last 2000 years, and we picked them apart, and we have the meeting in the theater play, so we can look at this and how it looked like. It's not behind us, it's in front of us. We are not being dismissed from the paradise with a flame sword, but we have to gain it with our flamed hearts. This doesn't bring us death, but the life. So this is what it looked like. Two things I want to tell you that were really important for me. We had problems because we used text pieces of Beckett, of Brecht, and Chekhov. And we said, well, there's still copyrights on this, and we can't play the whole play, so... It was the first time when I realized we are in a digital age, but in a debate that's not yet arrived at theater. The theater, they have this, the holy grail of the genius that wrote texts and the players on stage, and the people in the audience can just nod. Basically, and there was this debate: what's originality and whom belongs it to? And we made this evening, and we achieved it by putting in all the quotes on the back of the stage. And this was the quotation right and not copyright infringement. So this was basically the first moment where I worked together with the Chaos Computer Club, because I thought there might be some net politics. There are people who take care of this for a longer time than me, and it might be really interesting to have this debate with them. And this was put into this piece where I was asking myself, what am I as an individual person? Am I really individual or just a copy of a copy of a copy? You couldn't only see it in the costumes, but this was also carried by the pictures where people were walking down steps and stairs. And we usually... recorded this, and we set it in contrast to the live image, so you can actually recheck everything, and you can also create samples of it, and you can actually see how fast people get sick of it and how fast it gets boring. And the people start walking in a different way. Something else I want to say about this, because this is also something that leads us to the hackers. It was like we had a door and that had to open. And in theaters, there's technicians who are standing with a rope and they open and close the door. But we wanted to the sound guys to make a sound as soon as the door opens and close. And in the third place, there was also, as soon as the door opened, the lights should go on and off. In the normal theater, you usually have someone sitting below, stage managing basically, and that person gives signs and for example to open the door, to flash sounds and lights, and all these people do their stuff. But well, and in the back, you know, you still have like closing the door, making sounds again, and it was 800 times opening and closing a door. It was really, really a lot. And all the colleagues on the ropes, they were fed up with it. And we had the idea to have a hack, how to get this working. And couldn't we just do some kind of pneumatic system to open the door and to trigger all the same things at the same time, and MIDI sounds to light and sound? So this was basically the first technical hack we had at the theater in Dortmund. And it got even worse, so I come to the next work. And this is the borderline procession.
So the borderline procession developed in 2015 when we were thinking about Europe. I looked at Train of Hopes that were coming to Dortmund and all the dead people in the Mediterranean Sea, and I asked, why are we debating from the German perspective? And we are always kind of talking from the German perspective, because we don't know a different way. Sometimes maybe from a European perspective. But it would be great if we could, like with a drone, use different points of view and look at the European fences.
Die verschiedenen Haltungen dadurch verstehen, dass wir
and
eigentlich
understand the different points of view and basically just travel around the borderlines. And then I remembered there's a story where Joshua for the Battle of Jericho basically walked around 7 days and there were trumpets, and on the seventh day the walls broke down and everything became one. Suddenly it wasn't one or the other, instead it became one thing that was a synthesis. Maybe we should also think like that here and now, we basically combine here and now so that in the end we have one big thing. So this was kind of my fantasy. And maybe we have to build a stage like this that is composed of two parts, here and there. And in the center there's a wall. And here you can see one part, which is basically a house with a number of rooms and a garage. And on the top, you see sort of the other side, which is on projectors. There's cars, and you can see the apartment from outside. There's a garden where you can be careful that no one enters, and there's a bus stop. And this is how we have a picture of two worlds from inside and outside, from warm and cold. And in the center, there's a huge wall. And the audience was able to sit on two sides, either on this side or on the other side. But a procession similar to Jericho basically drove around this.
gegen ein Kameradolly auf
dem and there was a camera dolly
und die fuhren die ganze Zeit
and they drove around and around for 3.5 hours
das was wir nicht
and showed us whatever we couldn't see
Videobild von dem
or like the video of something we couldn't see or the video of what we could see
and
we'll show you what was seen there.
Können wir ein bisschen lauter machen vielleicht?
In the center of the road of our life
fand ich mich in einem
I found myself in a dark forest.
Was ist das für Zeit, wo ein Gespräch über Bäume fast ein Verbrechen ist, weil es ein Schweigen über so viele Untaten einschließt?
Zuerst komme ich.
Now it's me coming.
Kommst du?
Now you're coming.
Was man sehen konnte,
the borderline procession. So what you saw were commonplace situations of a mom sending her kid to school, a couple that lay down in bed and got up again. But we also saw a woman dying over a long time and a family saying goodbye.
Sich verliebte,
a couple falling in love, a crying child,
man sah Krieger, die nach Hause kamen, man sah
warriors coming home.
Was wir so sehen, wenn wir über die Straße laufen.
We saw things that we see when we pass the street with open eyes. But we only saw snippets. What could happen to them? Where is he coming from? Where is he going? And through sampling texts and different music, like a DJ, we tried to show a panorama of the world in three stations. The station, the world as it is right now, in its
wir haben die Krise gezeigt, die Momente.
In its contradictions, we showed the crisis where things are falling together, where we can't work together anymore. And lastly, the synthesis, working together, breaking down the walls.
Diese Erzählweise.
This way of telling a story. It became much more clear to us that this way of telling a story is very, very interesting and it can be a very exciting future avenue for theater. That we don't necessarily have this linear, normal procession, but instead the intendant has this, builds up something, and you, as the audience, can be the author of your own story. You're recounting what you see on the stage. There's 23
and
no one in the audience, even I as a regisseur, who was running around all the time and trying to do the live stuff. We didn't have the chance of seeing everything. Like, we can't see everything on the world. But instead of reacting with stress on it, and against the shock of, oh my God, there might be new stuff. Instead of that, we decide, okay, I'm telling my own story, and this is just a try at telling the world, and it will never be the whole world. It will only ever be a trial at telling. So that was trying out the borderline procession, and the audience really liked that. This free choice of perspective, what I look at, the which part, and we wanted to document that. And we soon realized that if we start filming that and cut it, then we will just do what we don't want to do, because then we will tell the story and not you. So that's how it came to the connection with the CCC.
Okay, so what we saw, that we kind of need someone, because we as a theater, we still have this tendency to do small things. Like this example with pressing the buttons and opening the doors. So if we could do this automatically, that would be great. There's some sort of technical issue which we're hoping to resolve now. Is it better now? So how can we conserve this and record this evening? And I'll show you a video that will show in the video right now, but I'll still continue talking. There's still an audio problem. Sorry about that.
Wir haben dann mit einem Laserscanner haben wir dann im Prinzip ein.
So using a laser scanner, we basically did a print out or like a VR experience.
Mit der Borderline allein.
And it wasn't only the borderline experience, but also with the next performance. That was about remembering and death. So this way, we don't only record borderline, but instead we do something completely different. The actor's texts, we used the actor's texts.
Arbeitsstand war. Wir haben auch mit der Kinect-Kamera.
And we also used the Kinect camera to scan the actors. So you can't see it here in the trailer, but at the later point, the actors were actually in there. And together with the cyber Räuber, not sure.
Und mit denen haben wir das dann zusammen gemacht und haben dann eben.
We did this VR together, and we had this digital variant of our experience.
Und es ist einfach nur total irre, wenn man so einen Raum.
And it's crazy when you scan this entire room. Then suddenly you can enter it again, even though it's not there at all.
Die alle da drauf gerechnet wurden.
So we made a lot of pictures that were all kind of calculated on there.
Also es ist halt so, wir haben mit den Cyberräubern zusammengearbeitet, die
and
haben dann aber wieder andere Projekte.
We cooperated with the cyber robbers, but they weren't able to work with us for the longest time. So now we still have this data, and we're hoping that in the future we can do something more with it, because it's been lying dormant, unused for a while, and it's really, really an amazing data set.
So if you want to play around with that, then send us an email. I would love to hear from you.
Jetzt habt ihr mich wieder an, ja. Aber genau das ist so ein bisschen unsere Suche.
But exactly this is our search. How does digital theater happen? And how do we do it? And we don't claim to know how to do it. There are permanent trials, trial and error, and playing with the content and with the tools of our current age. One subject that that I've been thinking a lot about was this permanent self-optimization and the question of psychic diseases. Sarah Kane, who's a very popular author who committed suicide some years ago, and she wrote a piece called 48 Psychosis, and tells the story about the therapy she goes through, the drugs she has to take, and in public speech we say it's a disease of the soul. And we are measuring everything about our bodies, but we don't find that soul. So that's how I come to find Lukas and said to him, what about trying to see the actors on the stage, not only bodily, but also what exactly they produce as data during what they do on stage. So in the beginning, when I came to theater, that was Crash Test Neustadt. I didn't really do that before because I'm a software engineer and doing something completely different. So then theater came to Chaos Treff, and then we started that cooperation, and that was the situation where I got started on theater. The first real piece was Psychosis, and now we'll see the trailer of that.
Mach schön laut, dann knallt's ein bisschen.
Can you
turn the volume up a bit? Build up a connection to others, to be together in an informative way. Being loved.
Schöner Ton.
Nice sound. So what we actually did was having this thesis, how you can use the biometric data to put this in one piece. And so I sat down and started to look what you can actually do with it. There was some Arduino-based technology that was put into the costume. We could measure the heartbeat, heart rate, the breath, muscle contractions, and all these things were shown on the stage and recorded. It was put into a computer, and I managed everything, and in the end I built something to visualize all this data and to put it on the screen. Mario did that, and we also put this into the sound and made sounds of it and effects. It was controlled by Ableton, basically. And this was the technology behind it. It was a lot of experimenting, as it usually is. And we use this to put this back. Usually, everything I do at the theater, I put it on GitHub. So if you want to build something like this, you can do that. But that was the story behind this. The great thing and the important thing about theater in the digital age is that it's not like the holy author that manages everything or the holy player, but it's a whole team. The players on stage, the actors, the technicians, light, sound, everyone works together as a team to make theater, and you can see this in this play. There's the musician on stage, the video, all the dramatic people. You can put this on the screen, and you mix it live. It's a kind of a band behind it that works together with the band leaders, with the actors that are in this cube that's semi-transparent. Stuff is projected on them, and they make a session together. And I don't know if it's 1 or 2 years ago, we nearly made it to the CCC with this play, but we didn't find a room, unfortunately. So let's come to the last piece we want to show you. This is the most current production. It premiered in summer, The Parallel World. When we talk about narration today and how we have to think how stories work out, isn't it absurd that everywhere in this world for many hundred years Hamlet is played and people say, well, this is the Hamlet piece, to be or not to be, this everything happening at the same time in different places at the same time. We usually talk about bodies on stage, and this is reality. But there's this virtual possibility somewhere else, other people are standing on stage, and is a theater really only just some kind of box where you sit and look into it, or as a theater that could just expand? So we asked the Berliner Ensemble if they want to work together with us and have this piece together, which we connect on the internet. We had seven actors from Dortmund and seven actors from Berlin. We put them together. Each team had two camera people and two mixers, and we built the same stage setup twice, and we told a story about parallel worlds, about quantum physics, and we tried to build a theater in the digital age, and can we play theater with people without sharing the same room? And maybe it's not right what I said in the beginning, that theater is the place where place and time just disappears. Maybe we just have to think bigger, and if it's live, it can be live here or in Berlin or wherever. We can show you what it looks like. So the big world ocean. Sorry. That's really embarrassing now. So you can actually see four pictures. There it is. The world has been traveled. It was measured. It was looked on the side. So where the people come from the Berliner Ensemble and in the Dortmund Theater, and they look at each other. This was what the stage looked like. On the right, you can see Berlin. On the left is Dortmund. So you can't fall from the earth. And when they opened the gates, the separated stuff,
oceans
connected, yeah, sorry.
als Schwierer auf meiner Hochzeit und zweitens, niemand ist schöner als die Braut.
Eine Welt ohne Abstände, synchron. Und diese Geschichte kennt keinen Schluss, denn die Schleusen schlossen nicht mehr. Sie werden nicht schließen. Sie werden nie wieder schließen.
Inhaltlich noch kurz die Erklärung.
Okay, so maybe an explanation about the content.
Doch ein Narrativ erzählt, aber
we did basically tell a story, but the story was only meant as a foundation to have a debate. We have a figure, Fred, who is born, who learns how to talk, who falls in love, who moves away, who gets married, who goes into a senior citizen center, and then he or she dies. And these seven stations, the Berlin Ensemble tells in the story that in the order that I told you, but at the same time, the Dortmund Ensemble tells the story from the end. So Fred dies first, then he's in a senior citizen home, and so on. So we see two ensembles playing at the same time on the screen, birth and death at the same time, and then learning to walk, not being able to walk anymore. And in the last scene, in the center scene, the wedding, we see, and in the wedding, the actors are playing with each other. They really talk to each other. But now, how does it work? So the task was that video and tone would be sent over really live, in real time. So we used some material and we basically had to kind of adapt it to this use. We had two video streams from Dortmund to Berlin and from Berlin to Dortmund, 64 channels of audio. Video works through Tika and audio via Dante, because usually the technology is not meant for this kind of thing, so they don't really like sending it out, so we had to kind of build our own little thing, and we used our own fiber, 10 gigabit, 420 kilometers, and a lot of switches in between, and obviously we spent a lot of nights working on that, and in the end, we actually had 4.7 milliseconds latency, and we managed to have this communication.
Das ist halt super wichtig, dass das.
So it's very important that this works in the early evening already, because all the communication before the theater actually happens is all through this communication channel, through this fiber. So many, many hours before the evening starts, it's very, very important that it already works, and it was very interesting for us that it actually works. It's not like Skype, where you talk and maybe a second afterwards you get the answer, but instead it's a layer 2 transport, that way you can see how it actually works. And this is a video.
Also hier singen sie sogar zusammen.
Genau. Also da kann man.
And here they're actually singing together.
Beide Häuser halt auch parallel singen können.
And it actually works that they sing in parallel.
Stimme und Bild ist natürlich wieder.
The latency between voice and picture is in-house actually.
Aber vom Prinzip her ist halt Singen und Sprechen möglich gewesen.
But in principle, talking and singing was possible.
Vielleicht kann man es noch ein bisschen lauter machen, weil man ein bisschen was versteht.
Maybe we can turn the volume on a little.
Also da sprechen jetzt zwei chorisch.
So now there's two people talking in a choric way. And people have been saying that this is basically Skype, but the latency that we have there, you can't get with Skype. This chorical talking. Luca worked on this for weeks. Dismissive of his work because he worked for it on it for weeks.
Auch recht interessant, man ist auf der Bühne.
And this is actually faster than phoning.
Telefoniert gerade und dann spricht man durch unsere Glasfaser. Es ist
and it's interesting when you sort of when you're on stage and you phone someone and at the same time our fiber still transmits the audio. The fiber is a lot faster. So the way we built this up is very clear. We have two stages, basically, and you can have four little screens or four big screens and two cameramen from Dortmund. On the left side, at the top, you can see that. And on the what happens in Dortmund is on the left. Berlin is on the right. There's a little bit of confusion who's the where at this point. So I basically traveled back and forth between Berlin and Dortmund, and you see the same stage. And I basically gave directions with my microphone in Dortmund and Berlin. So I saw them, I heard them, and they heard me. And at one point, I really didn't really know where I was anymore. I was lost in time and space. I didn't know where I was. Somewhere between Berlin and Dortmund, I assumed.
Salzgitterbad, das lag so in der Mitte.
In Salzgitterbad, which is a town in the center, basically. But the most interesting thing is that for actors, now acting is a great profession that is related to empathy and power and basically daring to open up to other people. And we thought, are we actually losing some of this special profession when we can't touch each other anymore as actors? And we made sure that we could hear each other very well during between Berlin and Dortmund, and that we could have screens and see what my colleagues did in Berlin or in Dortmund. So we could actually play together, we could act together. But you had to be more careful. We have to think of each other. We have to be more sensitive to each other. Because they're not right next to us. And we still want to do art together. So this was one of the interesting things that came out of it. And we thought that this distance might actually require a little more of thinking of each other, a little more carefulness. So these were four examples of what we did. We could talk a lot more about what we did during the last 9 years, but we're thinking of how can you basically do theater in the digital age. But our problem is that all of these projects were a lot of work in preparation and in normal theater. That doesn't really work. And normal theater doesn't have the time to do that. We can't prepare 7 weeks.
Was wir erzählen wollen, dann steht die Bühne und dann kommt das Ding raus. Das geht.
And that usually we only have 7 weeks for basically knowing what we want to do, and then after 7 weeks we actually start. And this doesn't work for these kind of technically complicated issues.
Man setzt sich irgendwie in Space, bastelt mit Arduino rum, lötet irgendwelche Platinen, probiert halt aus und bringt das dann mit.
Well, in the Hackerspace you're basically soldering stuff and trying out stuff and you take it to the rehearsals. And I really want to have a room in Germany where we can just experiment for theater in the digital age and also to research for this.
Und damit sind wir jetzt
and with this we ask a lot of people, and it's true. On the first of January, we will open a special place for this. The Academy of Digitalization and Theater will slowly start, and you can just show us the next one. Okay, it's supposed to be a laboratory for research. Per year, we want to have 20 people who get a scholarship somewhere between digitalization and performing arts. And in March, we will just show all the formalities for it. And the first 10 scholars should be there in summer, to be there for 5 months around, to work on stuff and to try out stuff and to experiment, not to have a financial pressure. And this is the one important point, the scholarship program we want to offer. And we also offer a qualification program with a special institution in German, and we want to work with people from light and sound, from stuff, how to work with the digitalization options, with our craft, and to optimize it, to make it more present. We want to offer stuff there on a regular basis for people on the theater, and maybe also for other people who are interested in this. And the third thing is, it's a training and a study area, as a master studies, for example, to have digitalization on theater, media art, cyber, whatever. And we're working on this. And it might take 2 years, but this academy will be completely running. This academy, you should keep it in mind. In March, we send out the documents for this. So if you're actually working on a project and you really want to hack Alexa or do a stage play with Alexa, or you want to do something with body capturing, I don't know. Everything where you say, we're working on this and we need money and we need time and we really want to do this for 5 months to share ideas with others who are interested in theater. Just keep an eye on this. You can get all information in March, and maybe we can see each other in September. This was everything I wanted to say. So, questions.
Herzlichen Dank.
So, thank you.
Ja, der Talk hatte alles, viel Technik auf der Bühne.
So, this talk had everything like technology on stage that works and all the stuff that you saw on screen, that was what you guys did. And that wasn't just theater, so thanks so much. And there will be questions and answers now.
Ich fange mit meiner ersten Frage an. Wenn man euch eine E-Mail schickt für
my first question, if I'm sending with that data, then how big is the response email?
Ja, nicht an die städtische Adresse, weil das geht nicht.
Darf nur 20 MB.
Don't write it to the local address, but it's because it's really big. Like, it's about terabytes of data.
Alleine die 25.000 Fotos in RAW sind ja schon ganz schön viel.
25,000 pictures in RAW. We could just send modified data area. So there's a web application for this to look at it. If you're really interested, just tell us.
So then bring it here for the next time.
Mic 2.
Hi, vielen, vielen Dank euch erstmal für diesen.
Hi, so thank you so much for that great intro in our work. And so you alluded that you're working more as a team in the theater. So I'm interested how you transform theater not only to the outside but also in the inside. So in what direction and how?
Well, theater has to change. It's permanently changing. It's basically a really weird growing construction, and we have to take care for the digital age and to change for this. We are dependent on each other, and I think the idea of just having the actors on stage, these are the artists and maybe the director and the author, and this was everything. Well, maybe a stage and costumes, but there's the workers. And I think this model doesn't work anymore. We need to have a theater that is a big team, where you have respect for each other and where you can learn from each other. That's both the artist on stage accepts that the technician that needs this time, but you also need the technician to know, okay, well, it's not possible to use time tracking in this case because, well, if you want to have the position as an artist, there's a lot to do in theater. So this is a problem that artists have different employment models than the technicians, for example. You have to put all this together, and we might use the academy for this to try out how the theater of the future can look like and what the work agreements should be to be more current. And something really has to change, and we're working on it.
Mic 1.
So my question is on the piece Parallel Worlds, and you said so theater is an empathic way of acting with each other, but you said that you were the only connection point, but were there other points of connection?
The first 5 weeks, we spent time in Berlin on one stage, and then we went to our own houses. It was really important not to say, okay, there's just two houses playing together, but it's two ensembles connecting. And it was really important to have all these rehearsals. I'm sorry for the audio. And because we were all connected with each other, I was the one who had the chance to be there on a bodily basis because I traveled there. In the last 3 weeks, the Dortmund people were just working with the Dortmund people and Berlin with Berlin, but in a bodily basis. But each morning, we sat in front of each other and we put the camera on stage and had the screen behind us, and we could see Dortmund in Berlin and the other way around. And we just discussed and debated on how to make scenes better. And I think we were really close to each other, but not on the bodily basis.
Okay,
thank you.
Mic 2 nochmal.
So I'd also like to say thank you for the talk. I'm really close to technology, and for 20 years now I've been doing theater and improvisation theater, and that's where my question is.
Auf das Improvisationstheater übertragen.
How can you transform these ideas on the improvisation theater?
Yeah, you can really do that. What's really nice about the Golden Age and also at the Borderline Procession, these are things that are happening live. You plan on something, some patterns, but what's actually happening in the evening, no one really knows. It's a lot of improvisation, and in both pieces I have a headset, and I'm connected to Mario and with the musicians, and someone standing at the sample machines. Hey, come, let's do this. Well, I can give you this one, and it's really live jamming, and I think with this digital play, digital toys, and live on stage, we are close to improvisation, basically.
Vielen Dank. Die Zeit geht jetzt aus.
So we have only a little time.
Persönlich Fragen.
So you can ask questions to the three on the personal basis. They are staying for the whole time.
Ja, dann hätte ich noch mal gerne.
Noch zwei kurze kriegen wir noch oder nicht mehr?
Maybe we have two short last questions.
Dankeschön. Dann versuche ich so schnell zu sein.
I'm trying to be quick. I want to get back at the question of social and financial collaboration between the classic theater people and the technicians, because there are some studies programs that are trying to bring these two together, and I do know some of them personally who are on a technical studies, and then they wanted to go into the theater and said, oh, that works in the with the hierarchy, but there was a lot of disrespect, and a hierarchy does play a big role. And so what are your concrete modes of transformation? Do you have concrete ideas for that? How you can enable that collaboration on the social level?
Well, we have to be in contact with each other. We have to learn from each other. And what I learned from these two guys is that it's amazing. You know, they actually learned something from me, I guess. And this is basically what's happening in the whole theater. We have to be interested in each other, and this climate of respect and curiosity, and to have love for details. We're close to each other, and we have to see that the financial thing is honest and right. But if you know so many people who are longing for this, theaters are longing for people who are here, and just capture our world and make it future possible. And we have the problem that there's just too few people doing this. German theaters need hackers, nerds.
That's a good keyword.
Darf ich noch?
May I?
Das war's. Wir haben hart überzogen. Tut mir leid.
No, sorry. We are just running out of time.
Danke auch. Danke. Danke.